my game. They're just going, hey, I need somebody to help me. And they're like, oh, Sweet Baby Ink can help me. And then Sweet Baby Ink's like, well, I got this opportunity to change things while I'm here.
Or another way of thinking.
Oh, here comes Vito to yell at us. Vito, okay. Why you let this guy go unopposed?
Unopposed on what? On what?
First off, he brought up about bounding into comics, not being, you know, leftist enough for him, and he was all like, "Oh no, they're wrong, and they're being biased."
Are you gonna defend bounding into comics right now?
You made me. I had to defend bounding into comics. First of all, you guys didn't read the article. You kept skipping things that were written in the article to focus on one part of the sentence instead of the whole fucking.
I'm not gonna
sentence.
Read a whole fucking article on screen. What did I miss?
Okay, the so the whole article, thing with the whole thing with Alan Wake 2, the lady gives a speech about being an empowered black woman. You didn't discuss that part of the comment. You just discussed she wasn't race swapped, so obviously that other part was fake.
Okay, did Sweet Baby write that?
Yes, they helped write the narrative.
Whoa! Did Sweet Baby write that scene?
Did Sweet Baby write that particular? I don't have that information. Do you have that information?
Shut the fuck up.
So do you know? Did Sweet Baby Ink write that scene?
Yes, I'm speaking
with authority. You're the one making the claim.
So neither of us know. I'm asking a question, and you're making a declarative statement, Vito. I'm saying I don't know. I would like the answer, and you're saying no, they didn't.
Hold on. Tony, neither of us know who wrote that scene.
Right.
So what do you want me to do? You want me to go, hey, did Sweet Baby write that scene? Is that what you want me to do?
I want you to go, hey, is it possible that Sweet Baby wrote that scene? To even entertain the idea of it? See, look, you're laughing like it's so ludicrous that they might put that in the fucking game.
But maybe they did. I don't know. You don't know.
Yeah.
But the point is, we don't know, and you didn't ask. But you had an opportunity to.
Hey, my super chats are open, cocksuckers. Okay?
You know what else was open? You know what was open? Us being on the panel. You could have had us there.
Shut the fuck up. No one is allowed to say that I didn't ask a question because I said specifically, if you have a question, super chat it and I'll ask it. You can't go, I don't understand. You had your fucking opportunity and you were a cheapskate motherfucker. All right? That's on you. It's $2. It's not a lot of money.
That is the most anti-Semitic comment Vito has ever made.
What the hell, Tony? You're trying to afford $2? What the hell, man?
I can't cover every single fucking thing. I can't. There's too much. So I don't want a discussion about what I didn't get because you had...
Did you have questions?
Shut the fuck up. Bruh. Look, what did I do on Twitter? What did I say on Twitter? What did I tell you in DMs? I said, I'm talking to Nathan Grayson. If you have any questions about Sweet Baby, let me know. I then read questions from guys like Lofty Pixels and whoever else. You
this
didn't say. Screencast
says, why cover it poorly then? What research did you do prior to this, Vito? What research did you do?
I have an entire document full of research. When did you say, ask him if Sweet Baby wrote this one particular scene?
Well, I didn't know what you were going to talk about until we were watching
really
it. We're literally.
If it's so
I wasn't important until we watched you say it and just like fucking let them dismiss it.
Bro, I can't. They have worked on dozens of games. I'm not going to sit there and ask that guy about every single scene. And
I didn't ask you. See, no. You're making a fallacy. I didn't ask you to ask him about every scene. You were reading the article and it mentioned it. It was on the fucking screen that you were looking at. It was right there. Right there.
He doesn't work there. If I asked him if they wrote it, he would say, I don't know. He doesn't work at Sweet Baby. What do you want?
You could have said, hey, do you think that it's possible that Sweet Baby wrote that? The same way I asked you and got you to admit that it was a possibility, you could have asked him.
Let's assume he said yes. What are you going to do with that information? What does that prove?
That proves that the conspiracy is not all this wild and wacky thing that you're painting it to be. That there is a possibility that it is true. That there's a possibility that the preponderance of evidence that people have pointed to might actually be accurate, Vito. That's the problem.
There's an equal possibility that whoever writes at the studio just put that in themselves. I don't know. Also,
you guys also talked about DEI.
Hold on. Why is that scene bad?
Why is it bad? It's just a bad scene, just badly written.
Why?
Because a
black lady in America complains about white people? You don't think that happens? You don't think there's like... Remember, let's put it like this way. You remember the Batman... Where Catwoman goes like, it's just a bunch of guys with white privilege or whatever. And everybody was really mad. And I said, black woman is a young black woman in America. Of course she believes in white privilege. That's very accurate for her to say stupid shit like that. Doesn't mean the developer believes it. It's what the character believes. Not everything a character says is something the developer is telling you. Oh, yeah, white people are bad. Do you really think that Alan Wake is about white people being bad? No, it's something a character believes.
Okay, but they have to approve that, right? They could have said, hey, you know what? We don't think that's good for our game. You know, let's just leave that out. Right. Let's not alienate part of our audience.
Well, clearly they didn't alienate. Well, I mean, whatever portion of their audience was alienated was outweighed by the fact that that game's a big success. So obviously it's a balancing game. Some stuff you put in a narrative, yeah, it might turn certain people off, but it also might be other people being like, hey, that's an authentic black character. That feels like black lady.
I agree 100%. The argument isn't whether or not it's an authentic black character or not. The argument is whether or not Sweet Baby Inc. was responsible for the line.
Okay. But let's assume they're responsible for the line. Okay, let's assume that we 100% they came out and they said we wrote that line. What does that prove about Sweet Baby?
That they're forcing diversity into games,
or that they thought it was an authentic character that authentic line that fit that character? Is it like out of the question for that character to speak that line based on who that character is, based on what we know of black women in America and the kind of shit they say, especially when they're like running in activist circles? Wait, that's the thing. Shouldn't characters in fiction reflect? They're also preventing
other narratives from existing. They're preventing other forms of art from existing. That's our problem.
I don't understand it at all. Which form of art is not allowed to exist because Alan Wake had a line about white people in it?
White people's art.
Forget Alan Wake. I'm saying in general.
I mean, there's a lot of white people making art. I don't like. Look, I think this is silly.
But hold on. Because did you notice that we went from it's not they didn't do that to well if they did it's a good thing that they did it.
You did.
You said it would be more authentic to the character. That's what a black woman in America would sound like. I disagree. I know lots of black women that don't sound anything like that.
So I
think that's not an authentic experience of a black woman.
I haven't seen the scene. Okay, I've seen like a screenshot of the scene. I haven't watched the full scene. I don't know the character in context. Okay, maybe there's a bad line in there, and she says something about white people.
Wait a minute, we're talking about authority without even knowing what the scene is.
Well, Tony, have you played through Alan Wake 2?
I've watched the playthrough.
It's a game about shooting.
Well, I haven't played it, but I've watched it. It's like saying, I could sit there and watch someone play it. That does not take away from the fact that I've witnessed the scene, right? You could laugh and say, yeah, Tony didn't play it, but I watched the playthrough.
Okay, but what is the concern? The concern is that video game companies go to this company, okay, and the company offers their writing services. Why do you believe the company offers their writing services? What is their primary?
Well, according to their mission statement, they offer their writing services in order to force inclusion and diversity in the gaming industry. In fact, the lady, the CEO herself, said, we work really hard to get minorities into positions. We protect them to keep their positions. And then hopefully that now these quote-unquote dope individuals will be in positions of authority in order to change the industry from working the way it's always has.
So they're acting like mob bosses, enforcers.
Yeah.
I'm having trouble following this line of a.
You're having trouble. So this lady who works at the company says they actively try to get minorities into positions of powers within the video game industry in order to actively change the way it runs and it works. And the output that comes out of it. She said it. I didn't say it. I'm not making the claim. I can play the clip.
On record, play the clip if you want. Yes.
None of that strikes me as insidious in any way. You now have to tell me why that's bad.
So you don't think that it's bad, someone forcing their political agenda into an industry that didn't ask for it?
But they are asking for it. They're hiring Sweet Baby. It's completely optional to hire that company.
So let me break it down this way.
No, hold on.
So
let me just say one thing. If the market has said, we want these companies, we want writing help. We want narrative consultants to make
the market
sure
said that.
Yeah, the market has not said that.
The market has not said that.
The
Call of Duty is one of the most popular games, and I don't think they're like, hey, you know what we really need to make the Call of Duty game better if we got an outside firm fucking consulting. They just care about shooting each other.
Okay, look, I get it now. What you guys are missing is the reason why Sony hired these dipshits is to have an excuse so they can actually file for the tax credits on diversity, all that bullshit.
Hold on, which tax credits?
The equity, diversity, and inclusion tax.
The
credits.
DEI.
And how do you qualify for those tax credits?
You get yourself a whole lot of black people and your production.
let me be okay. clear. The tax credit issue is completely beside the point. Companies have to be fairly large to have access to that.
Disney lived it for the last 8 years.
Right.
Now.
So one of the points I wanted to bring up there in a second ago was we were talking about sort of the mafioso sort of aspect of it. When you know, unions in the cartoonish industry did something very similar to this in the 1940s and 50s, right? It's the same situation. Basically, certain groups, certain unions, whether that was based off their union affiliation or based off of their background, ethnically, whatever you want to call it, there were Jewish guilds. My grandfather had involvement with them back in the day of artists and
the
cartoonists.
Systems of the 1940s.
Well, no, more of the cartoonist artwork and the like comic.
Are you talking about Disney?
Sort of stuff.
Oh, for credit.
Yeah,
that
exactly.
Was a completely different system altogether.
But my point being that the parasitic nature of it is, if you are all part of this same environment, you can go to a group of people and say, "Hey, maybe if you don't do the thing we want you to do, you get bad coverage." And so that was what happened then. Walt Disney didn't want to work with specific union groups, and for it, he got panned as being a horrible person by the media companies that were connected to those union groups.
He was.
Well, some of the stuff was accurate. Some of it wasn't. I mean,
we did an in-depth dive on Walt Disney. It was a huge scandal. He broke up the unions. All the productions that happened in Disney animation between the 40s and 60s were all supposed to be were under copyright, and they never paid a dime to the rights holders.
Right. Who says a thank lot you for that, not killing yourselves?
A lot of that had to do with the whole communist era and a lot of that stuff playing into the union work. Which
all right. Forget all that. Let's focus back on the interview. In the interview, Nathan literally said that DEI scores does not get you more investment. Then not 5 minutes later, he talks about how improving your DEI score was going to get you more investments. Literally, you know, he was literally went, no, see, DEI doesn't get you more investments. And he listed a whole bunch of reasons why. And then he started talking about DEI and how it actually works. He goes, and then if you do this and you get your DEI up to a certain level, you'll get more investments coming in. He literally went from it doesn't to it does.
I'm going to say I do not remember him saying that. What I do remember him saying is that you cannot raise your DEI score by the specific content you put into your media. So no ESG.
Based on
fund.
What? Wait.
People who've dealt with corporations who use these DEI scores. That's not true at all.
Okay.
The
give
content
an example.
Is one. What, like a company or an individual?
Give an example of how you think you can raise your DEI score.
The content you produce as a company certainly plays a role, and the things your people say work at your company.
Vito's asking for an example: a movie, a TV show, whatever. List it.
The one that I have any notoriety with is BP Oil, so it's not going to be the same equivalency.
All right, okay, let me. I'll help you out. Ghostbusters 2016. How are we doing?
Oh, okay. So
hold on.
No,
hold
shut on. The fuck, Tony. Shut the.
No,
fuck
no,
up.
Not going to shut the fuck up. It's my show, goddammit. No, I'm going to show you. This is exactly two effective ways for companies to achieve more measurable results in DIR. One, modifying hiring practices, align company recruitment and retention efforts with leadership's DEI goals, address biases in recruiting, promotion, and recognition. Two, cultural change, evaluate opportunities to improve inclusivity across all marginalized groups. Now, if you include more black characters in your game, you're going to hire more black voice actors. Therefore, you're going to have a higher DEI score. Correct or incorrect?
There you go. You're welcome. That's what I said a little while ago.
Am I wrong? Did I say something that was incorrect, Vito?
I think that it is a...
No. Did I say something that was incorrect?
So you're saying that you write a black
If you put more black characters in, you hire more black actors to voice those characters.
I don't think DEI scores are being raised because of the voice actors you hire. And most voice actors...
Okay, so that would be a modifying your hiring practice, right? No,
hold on. Most voice actors are contractors. They're not employees of the company. DEI is going to look at your employees, not your who you're contracting with.
No. It's
going to look at whoever you're paying.
No.
They're going to look at your corporate structure. They're going to say, how many executives are black? How many programmers are black? Okay? And do you know how many black characters you'd have to add to your game? Again, these are corporations with tens of thousands of employees working on these games. And you're saying adding three black voice actors is going to like substantially change their DEI score? Yes. No. Three black people does not change the make.
So let me ask you. So you have two companies, one that has three black voice actors, one that has none. Which one has a higher DEI score?
They're probably the same.
So you're saying that it has no impact.
That's not the case.
They're going to look at the... Then give me an example of how these... Okay, find an example of how they calculate it. You're just making suppositions. You're just going...
We're wrong. How do they calculate it, Vito?
Yes.
How do they calculate it?
They calculate it by looking at the corporate structure and the makeup of executives, diversity hiring initiatives. Okay, when a company says we pledge to hire... 20% more black people in 2024. Okay, you can submit that to BlackRock and see we're taking meaningful steps towards diversifying the makeup of our company.
Pledging and donating are two different things. You know that? Just saying.
Right, but pledging is big. Making these pledges, this is what you give to someone like BlackRock as evidence that you're making steps towards this ESG initiative. And they go, okay, we'll take that into consideration. Or you can say, hey, look, we just made, our CEO, we hired a black woman, whatever. That's what they look at. No, at no point can you go to them and say, in our Spider-Man game, we put pride flags. They will not care. They will not raise your ESG score. They do not look at the actual content of the media. You can't go to them and say, we made a Ghostbusters movie starring women.
Wait, you said it with authority. What's your proof on that?
My proof of that is interviews with people who have gotten investments from these ESG firms. Reporting on how it works.
Didn't they lie to you? What if they lied to you?
Okay, so if I bring somebody in...
I have actual statements from the people who are getting donations from these firms. You have assumptions. And you're telling me it's my job to go out and get information that disproves my point. Why is it not your job to go out and prove... That no, Vito, you're actually wrong. If you put gay stuff in Spider-Man, they get a big ESG boner. Why is there no onus of proof on you and all the onus is on me?
Oh, it's easier that way for me.
You're saying you have nothing, to be clear. You're saying I have no evidence that this is how it works, but this is what I believe. And Vito, you who actually have evidence, interviews and statements from people involved in these firms, you're the one who's wrong.
Yes.
Right? Yes. Okay. Okay, yes. So I'm in a very losing position right now. There's nothing I can do. I lose 100% in this situation because I've provided the proof I have, and you're telling me I need more, and I don't have it. So you win.
Earlier, I mentioned an example involving BP. My example there is I have a very good friend of mine who I've known for 15 years.
What
or
does
so,
oil have to do with games?
Oh, it's actually kind of funny. So they fired him, who was one of their, at the time, number two or three marketing sales guys for BP in Alaska, along with five other employees, for no reason. And then 3 months later, after he started working for another oil company, one of the guys who was his boss at BP, who also got fired, admitted to him that, yeah, they canned everybody because they were going for a higher score within ESG and DEI inclusion. That was the exact reason given to him. I've known too many people in specifically the manufacturing space here who have gotten that same treatment. So I absolutely believe it's going on in other industries. So the stretch to video games.
In hiring, yes. Sweet Baby is not a hiring firm. They're not a staffing firm. They have nothing to do with the hiring at these companies.
Well, no, but somebody instigated companies like BP and those organizations to do that. And that's my argument here, is these are the type of people that push those companies into those positions.
Here's what happens, okay? So BlackRock has multiple funds, right? And the funds are across a variety of different things. One of them could be, we're focused on AI. We're only going to include companies that, you know, focus on AI. Or we're only going to focus on companies that, you know, are doing robotics and whatever else. And you as an individual investor can invest in those funds. And one of the funds that they set up was these ESG funds, where they go, we're only going to include in this fund companies that we believe are focused on improving the diversity of their company, as well as, again, it's what, ESG. So also environmental. They're addressing their environmental impact. They're addressing their social impact and whatever the I stands for, okay? And you as an individual investor can choose to invest in that firm if your beliefs align with that firm. So as an investor, you can go, I believe, because I'm a big stupid idiot, because I think it's been proven that these funds are a big scam. I believe that companies that focus on reducing their environmental footprint and hiring a bunch of black people, whatever else, I think those companies are going to make a shit ton of money. So I'm going to put my money into that fund. We went over the numbers on the stream. The amount of money that has been invested in that fund controls, is $8 billion. The whole of BlackRock is something like $7 trillion, is it? It's a drop in the bucket compared to actual BlackRock, right? So it's one of many products they offer.
This is great.
Hold on, everyone. Shush. This is an article here. Integration of DEI in the landscape of video gaming industry by Seth Pewitt, right? So he talks about how to get more DEI, right? He says, moreover, the gaming industry must create an environment that is inclusive and welcoming to all gamers, regardless of their gender, race, blah, 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 blah. Game developers must consider these diverse perspectives when creating games to ensure they appeal to all gamers. This includes creating characters that reflect the different genders, races, and identities, as well as addressing social issues like discrimination and prejudice. You know, putting things in the game, Vito.
Is this about addressing DEI as a concept? Yes. Or is it about addressing DAI as an investing category?
So, that's why I'm asking.
This is not about DEI funds, Tony. This is just about the idea of diversity, equity, and inclusion. The funds are not DEI funds. They're ESG funds.
Yeah.
This is not talking about investing at all.
By the way, BlackRock
is not connected to BlackRock.
America.
So you think that by doing this, that's not going to have an effect on all the other stuff in the
company? It's not going to affect your ESG score. I can tell you that right now.
So you don't think that there's no ripple effect from doing this? That it exists in a vacuum. So they put this content in the game. They build.
Okay. Maybe more black people want to work at your company. Is that the argument?
Yeah.
Okay. What's wrong with black people wanting to work at my company?
Your company? I don't know. Yeah. My company's fine.
Here's the deal. March 4th, 2024. This was, 8 days ago. Okay? BlackRock is scrapping their ESG investing and pivoting to focus solely on the environmental component. You do not have to worry about this ESG stuff because they're not doing it anymore. Because it doesn't make money.
Let me be clear. That is not what they're doing, and I've read through a bunch of the stuff as far as the actual business angle of that decision they've made. They're not refocusing all those things. They're just refocusing into one part of it, the environmental angle. And that, right. By the way, if you read into what they mean by the environmental angle, that includes all the inclusion stuff. They're just rephrasing the terminology so that basically people like us don't talk about it anymore.
Yeah, they changed the words.
Stone face on Vito when you said that.
Well, because I need you have to point me to evidence of that. I have.
Well, I'm not going to go through Business Insider articles here on the stream and do 3 hours of reading for you, Vito. Okay. You were doing an interview. You should have done that beforehand.
Oh, I'm sorry. Another question I wasn't asked. Okay, so when BlackRock says we're dropping ESG, they're lying. And the evidence of them
Do you assume that when a company says they're doing something, they're being completely honest and not facetious or giving you half-truth?
That's why I wait for evidence to prove me wrong. So what is this wording that they're not actually dropping it?
Okay, let me phrase it this way, Vito. Can you show me anywhere in the article that you're reading off of where it actually says they're making the steps to reduce the environmental side, keeping that strong, but moving the other things away? They're not doing that anymore. It just says they're not doing it, and they're moving all of that into the environmental side. Period.
BlackRock is scrapping environmental social governance and pivoting to focus solely on the environmental component, rebranding it as transition investing, says BlackRock Chief Investment Officer of Sustainable Investing.
Right. So, Vito, what is environmental change?
I imagine it has a lot to do with emissions and oil and electricity.
Does it also have to do with people and where they move and live and maybe their upbringings, their ethnicities, their financial situations, or all the things that go into equity and inclusion and the things that they've been doing for years? It's the same thing. Okay.
Like, do black people create less emissions? It's not stupid.
No, actually, the facts on that is, so poor people who have a lot of stuff produce more emissions, statistically. Okay. That is factually true. Okay? So one of the outlooks on this and what this stuff goes down to, if you want to go down the conspiratorial route, some of this is conspiratorial, and I can't prove some of this. But the reality is most of the ideas that come from these companies that are supporting this stuff have the belief that the population is too large, produces too much, and owns too much stuff. And so the solve for that is renting and leasing and having less things and owning less stuff. And that is where that all leads back to. The ESG thing, the DEI thing to begin with, had nefarious actors from the very beginning in the banking industry working with them to form the entire existence of the thing to begin with. I suggest there is a writer named Carol Roth. She was involved in the investing industry for a very long time. There is another guy named Clint Russell who was involved in the investing industry for a long time. Both of these individuals have talked about this forever. Peter Schiff has talked about this, somebody who has millions and millions of dollars in giant companies. This isn't something that's just in a small group of people who believe this. There are people who are successful, who are involved in investing and notoriety, who believe that.
Okay. They believe what do you say? That the population should go down.
There are... in the underscale of a lot of the DEI people, the people actually pushing the stuff at the top end with actual power and money, they do believe that.
Okay. So can you connect that to Sweet Baby?
Well, yeah, I could make the argument that Sweet Baby as a company is one of many things that exist to push other larger companies into a position that pro-DEI and pro-ESG groups want. That is the mafia claim. That is what I'm. That's the whole point. Because, listen, if they have
how big writers, Sweet Baby is how big of a company would you estimate?
Small, but it doesn't have to be big. That was the argument I made with the mafia earlier. Because,
how small though? Again, like, give me an estimate.
16 people work there, according to Vito.
20 people. I mean, yeah. It
so with
be
10, 20 people, you can take a $1 trillion investing firm and completely. Capitulate this agenda.
It takes 10 people to
push the needle.
If you have the right ideology in place and you are equipped to do it and have the power, yes, absolutely.
Oh, it's okay. Just like that. Wait a minute, Vito. It's just like the gun lobby. It's a very, very small group, but they do have a powerful influence in their reach and their.
The gun lobby has powerful influence because the gun lobby has a shit ton of money.
Yeah.
Okay. Now,
but it's a very small.
I'll point out here: the gun lobby, in comparison to a lot of other lobbies, is very small. So the point here is that size plays a big point of view. If Sweet Baby was thousands of people stretched across the U.S., they'd have a lot more ability to enact these things. The whole point of things like what BlackRock, when they're talking about, we force these things, we do these things, and the ESG people and all these people saying the same thing. The point there is that you don't want a giant company doing this. You want thousands of tiny companies sort of doing the same thing. Everybody makes some money. Everybody writes their articles. Everybody's happy. And you get to control the industry, making it restricted in a way because you
can control the flow of content. Here's what I'm going to argue. We're talking about video game plots, right? Video game plots are massive. and these are massive companies, okay? So a video game plot not only has a main plot, it has subplots, it has diary entries, it has audio logs, it has so much that they need to cover. Now, what this company, Sweet Baby, provides is writing help. So they might step in. Again, the example in, what is it, Kill the Justice League, is they said, well, the main story was already finished, so we just needed these guys to step in and help with some of the ancillary stuff, like, again, diary logs, or like people on the street, what they might yell at each other.
Did you read the diary logs, Vito?
Yeah.
The ones that were putting down all the male members of the Justice League and then had a huge write-up for Wonder Woman?
So explain to me what you think happened there.
I think the people that work at Sweet Baby Inc. have a bone to pick with men, and so they wrote a bunch of negative diary entries towards the male members of the Justice League and put a glowing review for Wonder Woman. I think it's pretty obvious what happened.
Okay. So do you think that BlackRock can somehow, like, goes through the diary?
We're not even arguing the BlackRock. I'm just saying this is what they did. I don't care if BlackRock invested because of it or not.
I'm going to ask if you think that's possible. Do you think that BlackRock looks at the diary logs from Justice League and goes, well, they were really nice to Wonder Woman, but they were mean to Batman, so we're going to raise their ESG?
Obviously, that's retarded, Vito.
BlackRock very likely puts out guidelines for all of these companies in a
very likely. How likely?
Well, I would say that any big company that has involvement with smaller companies does that. So it,
so out there, there's a set of guidelines.
Screen Time says they look at the score given by Sweet Baby Inc. So BlackRock says, Sweet Baby Inc., you are working on the game.
Sweet Baby gives scores now. This is new. This is fun. Okay. So Sweet Baby Inc., what, plays through the game, evaluates the story, and then assigns it a score.
Why would they have to play through the game to evaluate the story if they have the script there with them?
Okay, so they read the script and then they give it a score. That's what we're saying. Let's focus on one thing at a time. There's an internal Sweet Baby score. This is the first time I've heard of this. Has anyone else heard of this?
I'm just reading the chat here.
Okay, I think that's incorrect. Does anyone else agree that's incorrect?
I've never seen anything saying there's a specific score given out by them. I assume they just give guidelines or suggestions.
Screen Time says yes while they consult.
While they consult, they give a score. What is it out of 100? Is it a star system? I'm very curious about the SBI score. No one has ever reported this. Guys, here's the thing. These companies are comprised
of... Let me ask you this, Vito. Wait, because we're talking about the score. Shut up, George. No. Because we're not past this thought. You don't think it's possible that BlackRock could say, hey, Sweet Baby Inc., you're working on that game. Does that game have a lot of... inclusion, is that game good for our ESG? You don't think they might ask them that?
I think it's possible.
Here's the Sweet Baby Inc. score.
Why don't you get evidence? Why don't you just ask them?
I'll be sure to ask them next time I'm at the Sweet Baby Inc. convention.
Here's an idea. So a lot of companies are firing people, right? A lot of people are getting laid off. Do you think those people have dramatic loyalty to the company that just fired them? And let's say they fired a writer or somebody.
Okay, but Don't talk over each other.
Come on, let him finish.
That doesn't.
Do you not think that if you got fired, and the reason you think you got fired is your game lost a bunch of money because this diversity firm came in and destroyed your story? Why would you not talk about that? Why would there not be?
Do you want to work again in the game industry or not?
Yeah. Maybe not. Maybe I just want to make independent games now. I go, you know what? Fuck the mainstream. I'm independent now. Here's what's going on.
You want to Gina Carano yourself. Good job.
Gina Carano is a great example. Clearly, there are people whose personal beliefs supersede their interest in getting a job in the mainstream again. And they can go independent. They can survive. And there is no reason for them to hold their tongue. Why can you not produce a single example of a person who says, Sweet Baby came in and destroyed my script?
Because
if you had that, you'd win. They'd lose their job. You don't think anyone this character black because Sweet Baby.
I agree with you 100%. So going by that logic,
a modeler who has already modeled the
Vito, character. Vito, I'm with you. I'm with you right there. I'm right there with you. I'm right there with you. So going by that, is it not possible that when I go, hey, I think Sweet Baby Inc. destroyed your script, Why don't they say, no, actually, see, this is the script. Here it is. Here's the script, Tony, which shows that they didn't do anything, and we wanted their character to be black and empowered.
They already said that. You want the actual script? They've said.
Yeah, yeah. I want the evidence just like you did. You want someone to come with the script and go, hey, okay, this is a thing. If I got a guy, George is now the writer, and he said, hey, the black, Sweet Baby Ink destroyed my script. Are you going to believe him? If I got a writer to say that without any evidence, would you believe it?
I would give credence to his claim.
No, you wouldn't. Just why you?
What are you talking about?
No, I wouldn't believe it. If some guy came to me as a journalist, if some guy said, "Hey, I worked for fucking some video game company, but I don't have a script and I can't prove the things I'm saying," I would not. I'd be like, "Sorry, you're not credible. I don't know you from fucking Adam."
Okay, let's put it this way. I assume he would have proof he worked at the company. If he could prove he worked at the company and he had a story to tell, I'd absolutely listen to him. I could say, you know, it's possible this guy's lying, but as long as he can prove he actually worked for the organization, yeah, I'd hear him out. What are you talking about?
Well, so, yeah, I'd hear him out, but when I wouldn't back him. I wouldn't be like, oh, this is definitive proof. I'd be like you said, he worked there, but I don't know if he's lying to me or not.
People are saying,
I'm not putting my neck on the line for some guy.
I want to point out, because the chat is mentioning the NDA thing, but the other thing is, so if you have a bunch of people who are hired under the same setting of, hey, these are the type of people we want, a lot of the people who are going to be hired for these companies are going to be ideologically similar. And on top of that, when they leave, yeah, you can have things like NDAs, and yes, there's an argument to be made, NDAs are bullshit, but I will tell you, as somebody who's had family who's worked in the media space, like, NDAs from like bigger media companies, they will fuck you in the ass. Like, they will go after you.
You think Gina Carano signed an NDA?
I don't believe. I believe she may have signed an NDA on part of some of the stuff she talked about, but I don't think the NDA would have covered some of the stuff she mentioned.
The owner, why would the NDA cover any of this?
Signed when you go into production.
No, the NDA would cover basically them talking ill of the company they worked for after leaving.
Yeah, non-disparaging agreement.
Yeah, non-disparaging.
Non-disparagement agreements are very common.
Why is Gina allowed to say crap about Disney?
Because Gina A is rich and Gina A is famous, and on top of all of that, nothing she has said might be under that disparagement agreement past a certain point. I always point out to people, she waited quite a bit of time in between when she started talking about the Disney stuff in depth versus when it actually happened.
Writers have to sign NDAs about not disclosing, what the company's working on. I cannot imagine that any NDA says you can't tell people.
That's a non-disparaging agreement. Those things exist.
Non-disparaging agreements
are extremely rare, and no, there's no. Programmers are not signing non-disparagement agreements.
When did we jump to programmers? Also, Clipsano says, why hasn't Chris Kindred been fired yet?
Is there any modeler within a video game company who wants to tell me they were forced to sign a non-disparagement agreement? Non-disparagement agreements are super rare.
Dick Show said TikTok veto. TikTok.
I want to say, I've worked with
all
with
this comes
people
down
in editing fields. I've worked with people in lots of video editing fields and production stuff with political content and with other types of content in that space. Non-disparagement agreements are not rare. They are kind of the net given for those types of things. So
non-disparagement clauses are rare because they're specifically anti-free speech. Like, most companies won't even try to. Let's see. Non-disparagement clauses are found in redundancy deeds or settlement agreements. Relating to termination of employment. So, let's see. They've arisen more controversially in employment contracts and standard form contracts.
Right. So, you also have to keep in mind, on top of the weight of those documents and the legal angle, you also have the weight of, if you come out and say this, everybody else in your industry is going to take note of that, and you may not get work further forward. And I want to point out that in the gaming industry, right, because I can point you towards examples in outside the gaming space that have outed companies they worked for this ESG and DEI.
This is gay. I'm done. Look, all of this comes down to the stupidest conspiracy theory bullshit, which is the reason nobody speaks out is because of a magic contract none of us have ever seen. It's a complete waste of my time.
Okay. Vito, ladies and gentlemen.
Bye, Vito.
Yeah. I think he's going to get eaten up by Dick.
If they fired Chris Kindred, would people be talking about this now? Probably not.
Arguably, no. Yeah, I think Clip Sam is right there.